He'll use people to actually do what he would do. Like pulling someone from one place and preying on their weakness.
Yeah.
To like, really? You know, so, I mean, that goes back to men needing to be around people that think and act and look like them. Now, I don't mean that like Joe and I can hang out because he's white and I'm black. I don't mean it like that. What I mean is you and I have the same mindset of living and trying to live a godly life, no matter what the cost is. And then you have those that'll say, I believe in God. Yeah, whatever. It is what it is. No. You know, we have to engulf ourselves around people that look and think like us, and that not only do they claim to be Christian, but they live and walk that Christian life. Because what I also learned is that the Holy Spirit, you know, because God loves you and because you claim him, he will expose your sin. And he will put it out there for the world to see. All right. So, yeah, we need to survey our own lives as well as surveying God's word. And you know, like you said earlier, reading on people that came before us, you know, Martin Luther, R.C. Sproul now, even John Piper, all the people that can help us think godly, those are the people we want to be around or be in the presence of. Because if we don't, and we just, you know, I'm going to do my own thing. I'm going to live in sin. I'm going to go out and do this stuff in the world. You know, I don't need anything else. You're basically committing, one, intellectual suicide, moral suicide, and see you in hell type thing, you know? So we don't need that. We don't want that. And I take a lot of my time and invest it in men that claim to be Christians. I take my time to explain to them what I know. And we don't have to be pastors like Joe and have the master's degree and the PhD like Matthew Everhart, but if we know who God is and we read the word, then we can teach the next person who God is. Okay.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Yeah. I mean, it makes me think of Proverbs talks about the, you know, the one who hangs around wise men becomes wise. And so this part, this is what we're talking about. You know, you hang around C.S. Lewis, you read a few of his books and, you know, he rubs off a little bit and all of a sudden you recognize, oh, Screwtape Letters, like, man, Satan, this is the strategy he implements and catches men with. And so, yeah, guys, I mean, surround yourself. This is just, even secular leadership literature would say, surround yourself with people better than you are. And that's all we're doing. We're reading books and it has a great effect on us.
I mean, Trump does it. But
there you go.
Oh my gosh.
Hey, people either love you or hate you right now. There's only two options. So you've either alienated all your listeners or, you know, you've just spoken their language and I don't know which. So I'm going to be on the sideline.
Forgive me, Lord. Oh, I don't mean to attack the president, okay? But I'm actually proving a point because he does surround himself by people that are better than him.
Yeah.
So, and I'm going to stop there before I dig my grave another 2 feet deeper. So anyway, so moving on. So, you know, you said you talked about reading earlier, all right? So, and if you got the book, you should be reading it. But so reading seems to be the key idea in a book, all right? However, a lot of guys are not readers. Unlike you and I and a couple of my other friends, we're nerds. All right. So I'm going to embrace the nerd. However, what advice would you give to men who find reading to be boring and difficult?
Yeah, guys, I would say don't think about so much setting time aside as just filling time that's being wasted otherwise. You know, carry a book with you. You know, I wouldn't recommend it on your phone just because guys get distracted, but you know, you just find that there's time wasted here and there. Maybe it's before you go to sleep or whatever, but if you read 8 minutes a day, guys, if you read 8 minutes a day, you will be shocked the books that you will get through over weeks, months, and years. And so, if this is important to you, if you really care about clarifying a true perspective, then, you know, keep a book on you. Find a couple of times when you can, you know, you're sitting, you know, waiting for your kid to finish baseball practice or, you know, waiting in line or whatever else, and just fill those little moments. And just a few minutes a day can result in you reading, you know, a book a month. And a book a month, 12 books a year, you will find yourself way ahead of where most guys in our generation are.
Here I go again. I'm about to put my foot in my mouth, and I know I'm about to do it. But men, we have this throne we sit on pretty often.
There you go, man. Yeah. Yeah, redeem it. That's right. There you go.
So, I mean, we'll spend time in there on our phones or reading other magazines. I mean, look, come on. Read a book.
Set yourself up to succeed. I mean, it's as simple as that. Yes, just stick it in a place. You'll see it. And, you know, it's not hard to recover 10 minutes a day. That's all it takes.
I'm going to try that next time. All right. So, all right. If a guy was going to read one book other than the Bible, what would you recommend? And why am I asking this question? Because I already know the answer.
So, you know, we've touched upon this before, but I would recommend guys get a copy of Pilgrim's Progress in modern English. So Pilgrim's Progress is from the 1600s, so you're going to struggle. But there are a couple of versions that have been set just to modern English, and so it really makes it accessible. And this is the second most read book in the history of the world, next to the Bible. So if your great-grandparents, great-great-grandparents, you know, living on a farm someplace in America or wherever else it was, if they could do it, you know, with their, like, eighth-grade education, those of us that have finished high school and beyond, you know, this, you can do it. And the wonderful thing about that book is it follows the character Christian, and he represents the life that and the struggles that all of us are going to have. And honestly, if you mastered really the first half, there's two parts. There's one half that's Christian. The next half is his wife who follows. But even just that first half of the book, if you mastered and really knew that story, and if you knew your Bible, I would wage that you would be well equipped to handle most of the situations you're going to encounter in your life. So yeah. that's why it was, you know, basic reading for generations upon generations of Christians. But I find so many men, even in their 60s and 70s, that have never even heard of it.
Yeah. And one thing I'm going to add is to my dads out there, I would encourage you to spend time to read with your child before they go to bed.
Yeah.
Now, Ligonier Ministry, which is one of my main sources in which I learn a lot of my theology and extra stuff that I want to learn outside of the church, if you will. Up until June, they're giving away all of their entire library for free. And Dr. Derek Thomas does a lesson on the Pilgrim's Progress. And you obviously have to get the book in modern English to follow along, but you read a couple chapters a day, you watch one of his teaching segments, and then you answer a couple questions. And one, it's going to help you retain what you read. And two, by answering the questions, it's going to give you a better perspective of what other people are thinking, which in turn will help you become a better thinker as well. You know, so that's one recommendation I have. I mean, obviously I like to read, so all of this stuff is not Greek to me. And I understand it, and I do reading differently. I do read on my phone. I need to get away from it, but also get an audiobook. You know, if you commute to work and you drive 20, 30 minutes to and from, get an audiobook. I used to hate audiobooks until I started commuting. When I was a graphic designer, I used to commute, I think, 45 minutes to and from work every day. And I got through an audiobook within 3 days and was ready for the next one. It's a great way to read.
Yeah, you can get them for free through the, you know, library. So, I mean, it's not a cost issue for guys. It's just a matter of, hey, turn off the music for a little while and feed your mind.
Yep, absolutely. Absolutely. So, well, Joe, that is all I have. However, I want to take a look at this when I survey the wondrous cross. Okay, so you said there was a fourth stanza or a fifth
stanza?
Fifth.
Yep, fifth stanza.
I'm going to write this in.
His dying crimson like a robe wraps round his body on the tree. Then I am dead to all the globe, and all the globe is dead to me. So this idea that what Paul talks about, being dead to the world and the world dead to us, that when we see this blood, which it's an image that only the Christian can appreciate, which to us, we see it's a robe. You know, this is his kingly colors. It's his kingly crimson. And when we see that, it changes our heart to the extent that we're willing to give up this world, the globe, and live for something better. So
I was on the wrong page. Oh, well.
Is it in there?
It is. Wait, hold on. I was on the wrong
page. Good luck finding it in the hymnal.
It won't be.
It won't be. I think it's in Spurgeon's hymnal. I don't know if I've seen another one.
Do I have Spurgeon's hymnal? Well, that's a new book I can get. Now, I want to read the scripture that's on top. I'm using the celebration hymnal, which is what we use in our church, and it goes to John. Now, you said earlier, prayerfully go and study John and pray through John. John 19:37 says that they will look on the one they have pierced, and reading that, one's capitalized. So obviously, one's talking about Christ. And think about this, man. You know, we're moving forward now. We've gotten to the point where we're going to start moving forward. Start intentionally thinking about your sin. Start thinking about, you know, if you are going to do something, stop and think, is this Christ-like? Is this godly? Because if it is not godly, you're hurting yourself. And I think about it like this, and this may be not reformed or anything. This is just my thought. Every time I commit a sin, I am piercing the one that I nailed to that cross. Okay.
Yeah.
However, he loves me enough to say, okay, you repented of that. You have been redeemed. That sin is cast away from you. Now, pick up your cross and continue to walk with me. You had a fall down. Let's get back up and let's keep moving forward. Let's keep trucking. Stay on the straight and narrow. I mean, look, guys, I know the struggles out there are real. I know the sin out there is tangible. It's there in our faces every single day. But the way for us to move forward is to surround ourselves by godly men and women and read our Bibles and read Christian books that will set your mind on a path of living a godly life. Mm. So that's my advice.
Good work.
As usual, I always give Joe the last word. So what is your warning label for this week?
If we're passive, if we're content with the status quo, then we'll be stuck in the status quo. And so just as you're listening, be thinking, be asking, guys, there's something that's tugging on your heart. You know, it could be any one of these things. Maybe it's, taking that hymn. Maybe it's reading Pilgrim's Progress. Maybe it's reading through and really going slowly through John's gospel. But ask God and ask the Spirit to lead you forward. And when you get that prompting, prioritize it. Prioritize it as if your spiritual growth depends upon it, and do whatever it takes to get it done. So we're often too content to just wallow in our guilt and shame and what we're not seeing happen in our life, rather than saying, okay, if God's leading, I need to follow, and taking those steps of faith. So guys, take those steps.
Absolutely. Well, Joe, thank you so much for your wise word, your wise work on this book. It has actually altered the way I do things now. And I just thank God for you, brother. I thank God that I met you 8 years ago with your glasses on a plane. One is still four-eyed and one is no longer four-eyed.
There you go.
But yeah, man, I'm so glad that I met you, you know, so many years ago, and that we rekindled this friendship over the past couple weeks. And look, man, I'm just praying that God would use this book and this content we're producing to draw men near, you know.
Yeah.
And I'm also praying and hoping that the men that are participating in this and reading this book, that they would get the courage to go out and seek men that need this and need this training, if you will, to push them to go forward. Amen. You know, men, we cannot afford to be stagnant,
right?
Especially in today's world. We can't, you know.
That's right.
So I know I said I was going to give you the last word. I'm sorry I took it.
Hey, that's a good one. I like that word. So amen.
All right. Maybe you should add a chapter, like when you update the book in a couple of years.
Men, yeah, when it's out of print.
No, when it's out of print. Men need not be stagnant.
Yeah, but, that's right.
But yeah, man, thank you so much for your time. And I look forward to doing this again next week. Next week is week 9. And then we got week